The idea of a jazz string quintet didn't convince everybody at once. It seemed impossible to conceive of jazz music without trumpet and drums. So, although their early live performances were enthusiastically received, it was not easy for them to make their first recordings. Record companies didn't find them commercial enough. After some disappointing experiences with big firms, an obscure label called Ultraphone decided to take a risk on the group in 1934. The result was a tremendous success. The by now constant presence of renowned American jazz musicians in France took Django and Stefan's fame abroad. And they recorded with such important figures as Benny Carter, Bill Coleman, and the great Coleman Hawkins, with whom Django jammed for hours in Paris jazz clubs. Back in the United States, these musicians spread the word about Django's genius. "You only find a musician like Django once in a century," said Ellington's trumpeter Rex Stewart, another frequent visitor. Soon, this marginal gypsy became one of the most popular personalities in Paris, a true national hero. This change in his status forced Django to adapt his behavior to the new circumstances. He modified his dressing style, buying the most elegant suits, and left the caravan, moving to a Paris hotel with his second wife, Nagine, and their pet monkey. At first, the hotel's owner protested about the mess occasioned by the monkey, but he never dared to throw out the famous gypsy guitarist he was so proud of having as a guest. Although always serious about music, Django wasn't known for his punctuality. He was usually late at recording sessions or club dates, and the two rhythm guitarists in the quintet often had to replace him. Everybody could forgive this, however, considering the magical sounds that came out of his instrument when he finally showed up. He was also an impulsive person who could stop playing if he thought nobody in the audience was paying attention to him. At the same time, he could play chorus after chorus if he discovered that at least one listener was appreciative enough. Sometimes he was in the mood and played for hours, whatever the context. Other times, he was simply not in the mood and didn't even show up at theatres or clubs. A fervent gambler, he loved every kind of game. His friends and family knew that if he wasn't at home, they could surely find him at a certain bar playing pool or card games. He was also fond of the unusual. Besides buying expensive clothes, he tried many things to make his stage appearances more impressive. During a famous scene, the character in Woody Allen's movie Sweet and Lowdown, in many ways inspired by Django, intends to open a show seated on a silver moon. That was hardly Allen's invention, but Django's. Once, Django appeared with his quintet at the Medrano Circus, explains Charles Delaunay. Enthralled as he was by any act that was out of the ordinary, and egged on by one of his musicians, who was something of a wag, he decided to have himself lowered from the ceiling on a luminous star. "It'll be real American stuff," he said with pride. However, when it came to the final rehearsals, a musician jokingly remarked that the rope looked none too strong, and Django was seized with fear. In the end, he preferred to make his entrance somewhat less spectacularly on a little truck which ran on rails. Over the following 5 years, the quintet made dozens and dozens of records that are now considered to be jazz classics and travelled Europe to great success. The song Minor Swing, co-composed by Django and Stefan, became one of their most successful recordings.